world will always welcome lovers as time goes by.
Hey, Sam, thanks for meeting me here at the top of the Empire State Building.
This is all Jonah's doing.
Well, I'm glad he left his backpack here.
I really like holding your hand.
I really like you holding my hand. We're looking at romance through the eyes of a grieving spouse. In the movie Sleepless in Seattle, Sam, who lost his wife to illness, is left alone to raise their son. He leaves Chicago for Seattle so they won't be reminded of all the memories they shared. He's left to stumble through the maze of dating again. Annie's already in love, or so she thinks. She's engaged to a man who's predictable and makes her laugh, but her heart turns to Sam as she hears his story on a late-night radio show. She has no idea why she suddenly feels confused about her stable relationship with Walter. Poor Walter. He finally gives her her freedom to pursue Sam. They meet at the top of the Empire State Building, where we can assume they began their romance. Romance is defined in movies and songs as moments where our hearts are touched by an act, a look, or a touch from someone special. Hearts and flowers, champagne and candlelit dinners, and dancing and walking along the beach all represent classic romantic moments. If you are recovering from grief, those moments might feel bitter or sad now. They can remind us of our losses rather than sparking new feelings for someone. And how do you figure out what romance is in midlife or after losing a loved one? Will your efforts to show someone your feelings backfire? Can you replace those memories? Let's get into it.
Becoming a widow or widower is a title that no one wants or asks for. It is thrust upon us sometimes slowly, as with a long illness, or suddenly. We are thrown into a world of darkness, silence, and loneliness. Our love didn't end with the partner. It continues in our hearts. Moving forward into a romantic relationship can sometimes feel like we are cheating on the deceased partner, or scary if we lose another love, or overwhelming to think about blending into a new family structure. But our love isn't bound by limitations. We have the capacity to expand our hearts and grow to love others. It won't be the same as before, and that is a good thing. This is a new book in our life, not a new chapter in the old book. When we are young, romance feels pretty easy. We haven't had a lot of responsibilities yet. We're free to do silly and corny things that may no longer fit into our new relationship. I think as we mature, romance takes on a new meaning. It is the little things that add up to being big heart moments.
I like it when you make coffee or breakfast for me.
I enjoy that myself. Stopping midday to connect.
Or sending a quick message of love through a text.
I know I always say social media and technology are not boons to society, but I suppose that is a very nice one.
As is doing a podcast.
Cuddling just to be close.
Dancing in the kitchen.
Watching the other person's favorite movie.
You're way better at that than I am.
And I get it. That's fine.
You like guy movies. But luckily, you also like rom-coms. So.
I do.
Yeah,
I
that's
do.
Good. You don't mind corny.
No, I can live in corny just fine.
Yeah. And you also make me popcorn, so that's good.
Oh, there's corny.
Yeah. Bringing home small gifts like a favorite treat or flowers for no reason or maybe tickets to a fun event.
I think we've both done that a couple times.
Mm-hmm.
Taking on a task that your partner doesn't like to do.
Cleaning the garage.
Ugh. I think we flipped for that one.
It's a constant in our lives, I think. Anticipating each other's needs.
I enjoy that.
You're really good at that.
That's fun.
Yeah, you're very good at that.
Greeting each other warmly.
Yeah, helping with a project or chores. Wait, back to that garage cleaning.
Back to the garage cleaning. Holding hands in the car.
We're actually sitting in our garage right now, and it's in a constant state of flux, so it's better, but it needs a little polishing still.
I have a dartboard I'm eventually going to be able to use again.
And we are doing the podcast from the garage right now, so.
Kind of nice.
That's kind of fun. All right, let's talk about love languages for just a minute. We all know the book, The Five Love Languages. It's been around for a while, and it talks about different ways that we can feel loved and that we can show love. For me, I think I need all five things, so I'm probably a little greedy in my love language. And maybe we're all that way, but some may just kind of bubble up to the top as being more important to you than others. I'm going to go over those five love languages It's not going to be the same for everybody. The first one is words of affirmation. So these are verbal expressions of love and appreciation. Saying thank you, saying I love you for no reason.
You're awesome.
Yeah. You're doing a great job.
You're amazing.
Way to clean that garage.
Ugh.
Spending quality time together by giving your partner undivided attention.
That is fun.
Yeah, we really like that one. We're probably equal on that one.
Oh, yeah. You're a little better than I am, but I really enjoy just being in the moment with you.
Yeah. Physical touch, hugging, kissing, hand-holding, cuddling.
It's all good stuff.
That's all good. Acts of service, which is helping with tasks like cleaning the garage. There's a theme here with the garage.
Ugh.
And I think selfless giving of your time and efforts. I mean, we don't want to clean the garage.
Well, if I'm keeping track, well, let's see. I did this for her today. I'm going to do that for her tomorrow. Knock it off. Throw the dang notepad away and just be in it for the right reason. Enjoy doing for your partner.
Right. Yeah. If you're doing it right, you're getting as much out of it. I mean, we all know that serving other people brings our hearts so much joy. If you're keeping track of how much you're doing for the other person, you're missing out on armloads of joy that you can get. And it lifts you out of your own struggles, whatever those are. I know that the times that I felt down or frustrated or sad, if I can go do something for somebody else, man, I am immediately lifted out of that funk.
And if you spend your time keeping track of what you do for the other person, it becomes resentment, and you may as well just be single. So, or you will be soon if you continue.
This is 100% accurate. Gift giving, that's a fun one. So even a small token, it doesn't have to be a big thing.
No.
You're really good at this one. You surprise me with little fun things all the time.
It's very enjoyable. I like it a lot. And it doesn't have to be a big deal. Just a trinket, a knickknack. I got you some, what was that bubble gum you like?
It was Bazooka.
Bazooka. I found some Bazooka, and she had said to me, I don't know, 3-4 days before, oh, I wish I could find some Bazooka. Well, I found it, and so I bought it for her.
And the real good thing on that one is you hate bubble gum, and yet you bought it for me anyway.
Bubble gum is fatal to adults. Be careful.
It's not. So what was the last fun, unexpected gift that you got me besides the bubble gum? Do you remember?
Oh, yeah, I got you a Codex.
And what prompted that?
What movie was it we watched? They used the codex. I can't remember. But I saw that and I went, how much fun could we have with that? Because the code could be, I think it's 6 letters. Mm-hmm. And it could just be a word of, you know, how we feel about each other or how we feel about the relationship or maybe something we saw that day. As long as it's 6 letters and you put something fun in the codex, like a piece of Bazooka bubblegum or something, and then they've got to decode it and open it up, and it's just fun.
So he bought me that and put a little gift inside. It was very fun. And there was no reason. It wasn't my birthday or an anniversary or.
I'm glad I don't have to have a reason.
No, you don't. It just took me a long time to figure out that I'm not mathematically gifted like you are. I'm more creative.
But you got it.
Eventually, yeah. So the challenge on the love language thing is to look beyond yourself and see what your partner needs. And what's the best way to figure out what your partner needs? Any guesses? It's something we talk about in every single podcast.
Communication.
And it may feel really odd at first because you were so ingrained in your last relationship. They just knew what you needed when you needed it and what your love language was. And now you're stepping into a new relationship and you got to figure this stuff out. And you may not want to take 20 years to figure that out. So talk about it. And if you're not aware what your own love language is, I don't know, try them all on, see which one fits. So we're not reading specifically from a scripture, but we're going to talk about a scripture today about Ruth and Naomi and the love that they had for their family and for each other. And it was called loyal love, which I really like that phrase. So if you know the story, we know that Naomi and Ruth end up staying together despite the cultural challenges that was going to create. So what the results of that were was that Boaz noticed Ruth's loyal love for her mother-in-law and blessed her. And then she reciprocates by loving generosity. And then that led to him, Boaz, wanting to marry her. What a great result of showing love. So the authors in the Bible parallel his loving commitment to Ruth as loyal love toward their family. So what kind of love is this? Could love between a mother and a daughter-in-law teach us what it means to love someone romantically? The Bible gives us a beautiful picture of true love, even though it doesn't fit into the most modern ideas of romantic love. Wouldn't the best, most intense, and fulfilling romantic relationship a person could experience be one where each person in the relationship acts in ways that preserve, protect, and cause flourishing for the other? To give and not take, to consider the other's needs above their own, to humbly sacrifice for the mutual peace of the relationship. I love that idea. So now that we've talked about things that build a relationship and ways to show romance and things that can be beneficial, let's flip the coin for just a minute and talk about some things that we shouldn't do when we're entering into a new relationship.
Comparing the new relationship to the old one. This can be tricky, as you are probably attracted to something about this new person that you liked in your last love. But if you expect them to respond in the same way, you can get tripped up. Some people like sunflowers over roses, chocolate over wine, or jazz over blues music.
On the opposite side, don't talk badly about your last relationship. No one needs that dirty laundry on the table. You might be setting up unintended roadblocks or red flags. Now, that doesn't mean you can't talk about it. You just don't want to base your relationship on dragging your last relationship in the mud. Because what are you building on? You're just building on a dirty dump pile.
Don't be afraid to be open about your fears. This can end up as romantic moments as you navigate this together. Hugs can fix a lot of hurts.
It's okay to be transparent and vulnerable.
Yeah. If you are in a relationship with someone and you love and trust this person, be vulnerable. I think it's a great idea.
Be sure to give yourself a lot of room for grace and permission to move forward. It's not going to feel like it used to, but it can still feel great. Being different is not only okay, but it can also be freeing. This is a whole new love adventure.
Don't rush the physical intimacy, but don't push it away. Take it slowly and let it build up. This is a chance to maybe try new things romantically.
So, on that note, my last partner was not a dancer, but I am, and I always wanted to have somebody that would dance with me. So I'm going to tell you our romance story that really flipped the script for me in a lot of ways. So we were just building this relationship. We hadn't been very physical with each, maybe a little hand-holding, and mostly in a comforting way, not in a romantic way.
Right.
Yeah, it was just a lot of arm patting and a couple of hugs, and it was we've been very careful with each other. But there was a full moon one night, a super moon, and we found a reclusive place where we lived out on a sandbar that only showed up in low tide. So we put our water shoes on and we walked out to the sandbar. So we're standing in the middle of the river on a sandbar looking at the full moon. And it was beautiful and it was peaceful and there was nobody around. The sky was lit up and it was just so relaxing. I had been in such a state of constant anxiety and worry that it was so nice to put all that away and just be right here in this moment. So I was leaning with my back just slightly against Sam. Not, you know, I wasn't too committed to it at that point, but just kind of leaning in a little bit and just kind of feeling his warmth and his comfort and his stability and the things that I really needed at the time. Suddenly I hear music playing from his phone and he asked me to dance with him. This was amazing to me. I don't think he even knew that I liked to dance. Did you?
Well, I knew you had danced.
Right, like as a dancer, but not that you knew that I liked to partner dance, right?
No, I had no idea.
Right. It just came to him. It was awesome. So my guarded heart opened up a lot that night. We just danced, not a lot of talking, not a lot of anything else, just dancing in the moonlight. It was romance galore.
Romance can be exciting as you travel down a new road. Enjoy the journey. As we wonder how Sam and Annie's relationship ended, we like to think they lived happily ever after. They probably had to move out of Seattle to do that, though.
Next week, we'll be looking at a classic comic strip. It's one of our favorites, The Peanuts Gang. Did Lucy have a secret crush on Charlie Brown? Did he have a chance with the little redheaded girl?
No.
Peppermint? You had a chance with this redheaded girl. Did Peppermint Patty love him, but he didn't have feelings for her? So the subject we're going to be talking about is recognizing love after loss. Sometimes the answer is right in front of us. Thank you for listening. If you like our podcast, please like, subscribe, and share. If you'd like to get our show notes or get in contact with us, you can reach us by email. One of our ideas is to start a weekly newsletter reviewing our podcast and adding some resources for you. We'd love to open up the lines of communication with our listeners. And we know it can be a little tricky to find us, especially on YouTube. So if you're having issues, please contact us and we'll send you the link. We're happy to email that to you. We'll add our email in the show notes.
May God bless you and keep you in the comfort of his loving arms.
Until next week, we are stronger together. Until next week, we're stronger together. Hey, Charlie Brown, you want to play some football?
Oh, no, not this time.
What? I just want you to kick the football for me.
No, every time I go to kick the football, you pull it out of the way, and I go flying through the air, and I land on my back, and I'm not doing it this time.
You can trust me. I promise. This time, I will not move the football.
Okay, I trust you. Ah!
I can't believe he fell for that again. He's kind of cute just lying there, though.
Ouch.